All right. It's great to be here today. How's everybody doing? Awesome. Well, to get kind of get things kick-started, in just a moment, we're going to show you a video about our ministry in the Dominican Republic. Some of y'all are very aware of what we do. Some of you have no clue. And so basically, we are in the Dominican Republic with our ministry, Transform 365, and our focus is working with at-risk kids that are affected by human trafficking. And so my wife and I, we have as our focus prevention. So we're doing a lot of things that are involved with school initiatives, job and education training, food centers, food outreaches, things of that nature, and working on the prevention side because we realize those things are what releases the tension of why kids sometimes get sold into a trafficking situation, sometimes the pressures of trying to find basic provisions for life. And we've seen God, we're just seeing God do some really great things. And so we're excited about what he has allowed us to be part of. And we would love to share more with you at the end of service today. Out in the lobby, we've got a little display set up. You can come by and you can sign up to receive our ministry updates that we send out. And we'd love to keep you posted on our progress, have you praying for us. But the video does probably a much better job explaining everything than even I could. So I'm going to ask the guys in the back if they'll go ahead and cue that up. And it's about 5 minutes, so let's watch that now. When you speak to human trafficking here in the Dominican Republic, what we really find is many people aren't aware of just how bad of an issue it is here. It's a beautiful place, but underneath all that is a very dark undercurrent. There are over 100,000 legal prostitutes starting age 16 and up. There are many, many other young boys, young girls that are way underage that are sold into trafficking and being used in sex trafficking. Primary initiative that my wife and I have through Transform 365 is to do everything in our power to help close that pipeline with a focus of serving at-risk kids, being Jesus to them.
I help be a voice for children who have no voice.
The first thing we strive to do when we are on the ground here is we want to get involved in the community. We want to engage the community in relationship building. That's really where our work starts for us.
Good job. You meet that physical need and then share the love of Jesus Christ, that Jesus loves you.
There are several opportunities to serve kids here, one of which is the Haitian immigrant community. We got to know a lady named Daniela. She had a third grade education. She was a single mom with three daughters. Struggling to provide for kids. Her kids are not in school. And in April of 2015, Daniela suddenly died.
Their father, he has to go find work. And for the Haitians here in the Dominican Republic, that is not an easy task. And so the girls are really raising themselves.
When we are here by ourselves, anytime something bad happens in our neighborhood, the others blame us and curse us.
Then we want to go to the second level, which is how can we truly begin to pour into their life that makes a difference not only today but for their future. We also recognize and understand the absolute greatest need that any of the Haitian or Dominican people we work with have is they have a need of Jesus Christ as their Savior. And so we want to see a mindset in those girls change, their heart and mind focus, that they have hope for a better future.
When we didn't have food or water, Mr. Jeff and Ms. Joe brought it to us, and now they are teaching us to speak Spanish and English. I'm happier now because now I can learn.
I was just reading my Bible, and the Lord said, pick up a piece of paper, pick up a pencil, and I've got something I need you to sketch out. I had this whole sketch that the Lord was giving me where we would end up being in the Dominican Republic one day.
And so we just kind of held onto that drawing for a little bit. 2 years later, we're driving through a little mountain community on the way to the North Coast.
We come around the curve and I go, stop.
And we look off in the distance and it's like the identical scene to what my wife had drawn that day. It was like that vision coming to reality that God had shown us a glimpse now.
We need to have your not only prayer support but the financial support so that we can buy this land.
It's going to be strategically positioned in communities close by where human trafficking is a high problem, and not only minister to those kids in a prevention way, but also have a portion of our ministry and property set up where rescue and restoration can be addressed as well.
We know without a shadow of a doubt that this is where the Lord has called us.
Without someone helping them, their future's going to be like so many children here. A situation where they have to literally give themselves away to people who don't care anything about them.
That maybe another soul will be in heaven one day, I pray, because of being called to do the work of the Lord.
That's pretty much it in a nutshell. I mean, that gives you the big picture view of what we're doing in the Dominican Republic, and I could probably talk for a long time about just the ins and outs of what we're doing in the DR. Today, I want you to take your Bibles. I want you to turn to the book of Acts. Just turn right to the beginning part of Acts. And while you're doing that, let me just share a couple things with you that I think would be of great benefit and blessing. First is, I have this book up here. A lot of times, you know, we'll go to churches and we'll talk to people and they'll say, well, tell me more about what does human trafficking look like as far as how are you strategically focused on the three steps of prevention, rescue, and restoration? And so I can tell you this, it's still a work in progress in the Dominican Republic. It's very easy for us to do prevention projects right now, but rescues are all running through an organization called IJM. How many of y'all have ever heard of International Justice Mission? Anyone here has heard of that? Okay, several of you have. And IJM, they landed in the DR. They opened their office in 2013. And it's a good thing that they're there, but it also can be a challenge because there's additional handcuffs to being able to go in and do what you need to do. But they're meant for good, not for bad. And so it's a process, is what I'm trying to say. It's not something that happens quickly. There are definitely hiccups along the way and challenges. For example, in the Dominican government, they have an organization called CONANI. CONANI, their responsibility is basically when underage kids get rescued out of prostitution or out of trafficking, they get passed over to CONANI. CONANI's job is like a holding place and kind of to get them settled and then transition them to ministries like ours where they can now have long-term care. But the problem is, many times in CONANI's setup, it's hard to keep track. Sometimes the kids, they run away, and they run right back into prostitution. It's a mess at times. It's messy. But can we just all agree, sometimes ministry is messy. It's difficult. It's not easy. But the Lord is working through all of that. So you need to pray not only for us, but pray for groups like IJM and others that are on the ground, because all of us collaborate. All of us work together. All of us are part of the opportunity for the solution with the Lord's help and His power working through the situation, we can, you know, see a great difference made. And so these three girls are just for our ministry are a great example. They came to us 2 years ago, wasn't it, babe? In summer 2014. Okay, over two years now, and so. Jill spent some time with them in their home when their mom was living, and we got to know them. Long story short, last April, right before we moved to the Dominican as full-time missionaries, the mom passed away. We didn't know there was a dad in the picture. We found out they were staying with this man who was their the dad of the two younger girls, and we didn't know him. So obviously knowing the culture of the DR, red flags started going off in our mind. We got there and discovered the dad appears to be a good man. He's trying to provide, but there's just some challenges in that family and the dynamic. And so we've come alongside them to help. But we know in their neighborhood that they're in that they face so many different types of challenges, especially with just, you know, just promiscuity, not of their doing, but others doing, things that have been forced on them. And so we need your prayers as we work with them. And we are in the process of moving them into our first safe house in a neighborhood that's just 5 minutes from our house, a little community called Hato Mayor. It's really close to the school that we've got the girls set up going to now. So please, please, please be praying with us and pray for those three little girls. The oldest, Benjina, is, and honey, you correct me if I'm wrong, Benjina's 10, Francesca's 9. She just had a birthday right before we came back. And then Darwin is 6. And so be praying for those three girls and pray for their father, Willie, and us as we work with them and our team that's down there in the Dominican right now. And so, you know, God has blessed us with people around us that are helping us with this so that we don't have to try to tackle this alone. And so we're so grateful to God for his help in that. And this is a book someone passed on to me. It's called God in a Brothel. I don't know if any of you have heard of this, but I would say to you, if you're wanting to learn more about just what's involved and how people go about being involved in this, how can I pray better for missionaries and other groups that are doing this, if you want to understand the ins and outs a little bit better, this is a great book for that. This is written by a guy who was an undercover policeman from New Zealand, and he did this for 4 years as part of his ministry. And so I just want to encourage you to read this. It'll be something that'll really be eye-opening, and it'll help you just better to be aware of what's going on from a spiritual standpoint and what's needed. So also just want to share, I've gotten a couple of comments. Some people say, hey, I like that shirt. What is that shirt all about? I like that. And so this is a typical Dominican. They call it a chacabana. In different Spanish cultures, I'm sure they have different names for it, but it is used a lot of times worn like with weddings, or it's worn in special events, things like that. I like it because of the slimming effect. I need all the help I can get. It's not a great slimming effect, but helps just a little bit, Pastor Dave, just a little bit. So I decided to wear this, give you a little cultural experience from the Dominican this morning. But you know, when we talk about missions, a lot of people think, okay, so missions is a location, it's a function of, you know, kind of what kind of ministry you do. Like most people would hear what we do, and okay, well, that's different, you know. Okay, we'll pray for you. I don't want to get involved in that, but I'll pray for you. And oh, it's in the Dominican Republic. And so we think of missions, we think location. And I want to tell you this, and I think Pastor Dave and I were having a conversation. I know he mentioned this to you a few weeks back on a Sunday morning, but it really is true. Missions is not about a location. It's not about where you go to serve. It's not about how you're serving. Missions is what we do if we're Christians. Life is mission. We've heard the phrase sometimes people say on mission, and that's really what missions is. Missions is not about, it's much less about where and what. It's much more about the breathe-in, breathe-out relationship with Jesus Christ, that daily walk and just simply being obedient to what he's calling us to do. That's really it in a nutshell. That's living on mission. It has nothing to do with all those other things. And, you know, I tell people all the time, I'm like, you know, the location and what we're doing, it's just details. It's just details. Even the financing of it and the budget, it's just details. It really is. That is much less important than our daily relationship with the Lord, walking with him and just doing what he's calling us to do. So let's take a moment and let's pray, and then we're going to get into our message here. Father God, we just thank you so much. God, I thank you for every person who's here. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity for us just to open your word together, be encouraged and challenged, Lord. And God, I pray that you would just take the truth of your word, God, and encourage our hearts, touch our hearts, challenge us. Lord, to be your hands and feet in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so as we continue this, how many of you would agree we're living in a world that has lost its mind? Sure seems that way, right? I mean, it seems like everything is just going out of control. Marriage and family, the foundations of that are being destroyed, and that's going crazy. Our government, world leadership, they're losing their minds. And, you know, and as people, we have forgotten how to interact with each other in a way that, like, just to get, in a way that we can get along and still have a different opinion. And even with our connectivity, you know, we're connected without really being connected. You know, we're wired, but we really don't have deep, meaningful relationships a lot of times. And so we're in a world that seems like it's just spiraling out of control. And so when we think about how do we, take, what we learned spiritually, we learned in the scriptures. If we're a believer today, if you have a relationship with Christ, or even if you're searching and you wouldn't describe yourself as a Christian, but you're searching for meaning and purpose in your life and you're trying to make sense of it all, how do you do that? Where do you find that? How can you have peace? How many of you just wake up some days and just wish, man, I just want to have some peace for a little bit? And sometimes we do that by getting away. Sometimes we do it in different ways, but we're searching for peace. We're searching for purpose. And so I've heard some people say things like this. We've heard this, and we've probably said it before. Life is 10% what happens to you and 90% how you respond to it, right? Okay, we've heard that, and there's some truth there. Man, a lot of times we say that in relation to circumstances that happen that are outside of our control. Unexpected things come up, and it's way, and there's truth in that, and we encourage each other with that. But, here's part of the issue. There's a problem that arises with that, because when you've lived enough life, you realize sometimes people's motives aren't pure, and things happen, and right? And so sometimes cynicism creeps in. You ever get cynical about people? Or about life sometimes. And so sometimes our outlook or our view on life can be skewed because of just the reality of people and the reality of life. Life can change quickly. How many of you know that to be true? Job losses. Some of you may have had a job transition this past year. Some of you may have lost a loved one this year. Some of you may have had an illness, an unexpected, serious illness that came up. Life can change quickly. Now, on the positive side, Brother Mike, I'm really glad life changed quickly for my Clemson Tigers yesterday. They were on the ropes, and I can tell you prayer works because the NC State kicker missed the kick. It went wide right. All right? But things can change fast. Things can change quickly on us. And so here's a great question I heard this week. And I relate it to a scripture verse in James 4:4. I want you to turn there with me just real quick. Hold your spot in Acts and go to James 4:4. James chapter 4, verse 4. Actually, I think it's James 4:14 is what I was looking at. Yes, James 4:14. It says here, you don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. What is your life? We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. For you're a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Now, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news or seem doom and gloom, but can we just admit the reality is we don't know if we're going to be here tomorrow. That is truth. We don't know. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring, and yet we spend so much of our time and so much of our life focused on the here and now. Everything we do is focused on here and now for the most part. I heard a question this week, and I think it's great. I want to pass this question on to you, and here it is. Is the focus of your life your last 10 to 20 years on earth, or is your focus on life your first 10 million years in eternity? Okay? Now think about that. So many of us focus on retirement, and we focus on, I'm going to live the easy life, the easy road, that if I could just get there, man, that will be heaven on earth. But there's so many commands in Scripture that tell us to put our focus and attention on eternity. If we really believe the Bible at what it says, then as Christians, we're going to live forever. As followers of Jesus Christ, this world is not our home. And if it's not, and I believe this to be true, whatever we believe, we do. It's not whatever we believe, we say. We don't just say, we don't say what we believe, we do what we believe. Right? Now, I was joking about Clemson a minute ago, but the truth is with having a team I support, I wear their clothes, I go to their games, I watch the games if I can. I couldn't hardly watch yesterday. It was nerve-wracking. But do you understand what I'm saying? All my friends in here know I'm a Clemson fan. All right? So here's what's true. When it comes to the Lord, it's not what I say. It's what I do. It's how I live. It's the things that I'm involved in my life, the focus of my life. That didn't start in the Dominican Republic. My wife and I were sharing with a youth group on Wednesday night this week that we didn't just have faith when it came to going to the Dominican Republic. We didn't just find faith in Christ or exercise faith once we got there. It's a series of events in our life that led us there because of a relationship with Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? It's a process. And for us, that's where God told us to go. God may not tell you to go to the Dominican Republic. He may want you to stay right here. Here's what I believe, though, about every believer. I believe we ought to be willing to go wherever he wants us to go and do whatever he wants us to do because he's in charge, not me. He's in charge. Is the focus of your life your last years on earth, or is it your focus? Is your focus on eternity? You know, contrary to popular opinion, the world is not going to end November 8th. All right? So the world is not going to end unless Jesus decides to come back on Election Day, and that would be an interesting parallel. That'd make for an interesting conversation, right? The Lord comes back November 8th. Right? That would be a great thing. So, but you know what? The reality is I'll still be a born-again, forgiven follower of Jesus Christ. My purpose for living will still be intact after November 8th. None of that's changing. None of that will be affected by November 8th. And so my life, my focus, none of that changes because it's not about November 8th. It's about a Savior who ultimately, even though I don't like to like this thought sometimes and I have to struggle with it, he's in charge of this place that's going out of control. He predicted it would happen that way. And that's true to what he said. And so, is it possible for us to live a life of meaning and purpose like John 10:10 talks about? What is life on earth supposed to look like? And so that's why I wanted to go to the book of Acts this morning. I want us to talk about just for a moment, how did early Christians live? What was their focus? What mattered to them? What do we see them doing? What kind of habits did they have in their life? And so I want you to look in Acts 1. We'll just start there. We're going to move around just a little bit. So just kind of roll with me here for a few minutes. And let's start in Acts 1. And I want us to we're going to read some scripture, some passages, and make some application. One thing that we notice is that there was a priority of letting the Holy Spirit direct and lead before they acted. And they knew this because Jesus had said, hey, I want you to stay right here in this upper room, and I want you to wait on the promise of the Holy Spirit. Let's look in Acts 1:1. It says, in the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said, it's not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, and the end of the earth. And so I want to stop right there for a minute. There's a, you know, if we just parked right there, we could spend the rest of our time there. It's a great passage, and you know, when we depart company from someone, famous last words, right? The things we say are the things that are most important to us. I know as Pastor David's been here, and y'all have gone through the some evangelism studies in the past. I know you've talked about the Great Commission, the Great Commandment, and that when before Jesus left, he said, "Hey, you're to go and go and make disciples." You're to proclaim the gospel, and by the way, the gospel is not pray a prayer. It's surrender. It's surrender. It's surrendering to a life lived for Christ. It's giving up my life for his life. It's an exchange. An exchange happens in that process, in that decision. There's an exchange. And so we have this opportunity to be used of God to share the gospel message, but we wait on the Holy Spirit to direct and to use us. And that goes to all the world. It's to go out to all the world. We're to be obedient to take that gospel message wherever he wants us to take it. But then also, another thing is we're to have a unique love for each other. In Acts 2, verses 42 to 47, let's look there. Acts 2, 42 to 47, it says, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day to day attending temple together, breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." Now, think about this for a second. Look at that and ask yourself, do I know a body of believers in 2016 that are living that way? Think about that. Ask yourself this question: am I living that way? There's some great stuff in there, but there's some challenging stuff, right? When's the last time you heard of a person having a need in your church or in your community, and you went and sold something that maybe you were blessed? I mean, and we're all blessed. Let's just be honest. You're living in America, you're blessed. I can tell you that right now. I don't care. Your worst day here is the best day for a lot of people around the world. We are so blessed. We've seen it in the Dominican Republic, and we have not yet made a trip to Haiti. Haiti is even in worse condition than the DR as a whole. We're talking about, I mean, deplorable conditions. Those three little girls, they live in deplorable conditions. Okay, where neighbors come and leave excrement in front of the door and accuse them of it, and then tell the owner that the girls did it and they have to clean it up. Your worst day here is a lot better than a lot of other people. And so I say that to say, look at that passage. If we really believe that the Bible is God's word and we're reading through that, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. You know what the gospel is? It's not just one passage. It's not just four books of the Bible. The whole thing is the gospel. The whole thing is the testimony of God's. This book is the testimony of God's love for you and I. It's a testimony of why God brought this place into being to begin with, and how we had a relationship with him, and how we messed it up. God didn't mess it up. We messed it up. And we're doing a great job of keeping that going. And so God, in spite of ourselves, he made a way for us to still live in relationship with him through the person of Jesus Christ. The whole book is the gospel. Sometimes we get really good about taking a passage and saying, okay, well, I'm doing really great here, pat ourselves on the back. And we forget the Bible is pretty expansive. I think one of the greatest things God could do for us spiritually is to give us all a dose of humility, spiritual humility. Because don't we have a lot to work on? I know I do. Man, I know I do. Just if you take that one passage to pray with one another and to spend time together. Some of you, maybe God's calling you today just simply to invite somebody over and spend some time with them. When's the last time you did that? When's the last time you spent time with a believer you didn't know or who wasn't just like you, but you spent some time with them and just poured into their life a little bit? When's the last time you served someone else? When's the last time you made it a focus to study God's word in a personal way, in a deep way, a meaningful way? We see so much in Scripture. There was a unique love for one another. And then there was a laser beam focus about getting the gospel message out. There was a strategic focus on sharing about Christ, about sharing him with others. And, you know, we get off track with all these other things going in the world, and we don't keep the main thing the main thing. It's like all this life stuff happens. It's like we think God's up in heaven going, I didn't see that coming. Right? We would never say that, but we kind of live that way. Like, God's like, oh, why? What? How'd that, did, you know, what happened there? No, God's aware of everything. He knows. He knows. And so I want to tell you this when it comes to evangelism. I grew up in church thinking there was one way to share your faith. You know, one way to get it done. One way. And that was just confrontational evangelism. That was what was modeled for us growing up. And it was, you know, hey, just, you know, do you know for sure today you're going to heaven? You know, one of those kind of things. And, of course, as a youth pastor, you always wait till you take the kids, you know, to the amusement park and get them on a really scary roller coaster and they think they're going to die. And you're like, hey, do you know for sure you're going to heaven today? Right? And so, but, you know, there's all kinds of different ways to share what Christ has done in your life. There is that confrontational way. Sometimes God just calls and says, hey, you need to tell them. You know, time's running out for them. You need to tell them. Had a gentleman that was a former Vietnam vet that attended our church when I was pastoring up in Forsyth County. And he had a heart attack, and we had been concerned about him, and he ended up having a heart attack, and he was in a hospital in Knoxville, Tennessee. And, of course, we didn't know. We didn't know if he was going to live or not. And so it's kind of, I got to be honest with you, you know, it was a little inconvenient, you know, but the Lord's like, you need to go to Knoxville, and you need to go tell him. I'm like, okay, I'm going to Knoxville. So I went, and, you know, I had some family in the area, so I went and saw them, spent the night with them, but went to the hospital and spent some time. Colonel McDonald Valentine, crazy, crazy man, very colorful guy. But, you know, he prayed to receive Christ that night. And it wasn't because of anything I did. It was because I just did what God told me to do. God does the saving. God does the work in a heart. Our job is just to be obedient. Now, as far as God's concerned, between me and God, God wasn't holding me accountable for what McDonald Valentine decided, whether he trusted Christ or didn't trust Christ. That wasn't my load to bear. My load to bear was I need to be obedient. If that's what God's telling me to do, I need to go and trust God to do whatever he's going to do. And so there's confrontational evangelism. We see that in Acts 2, verses 36 through 41. Peter's preaching, right? And he's sharing the gospel. And look in these verses. He says, hey, let the house of Israel know, therefore, verse 36 of chapter 2, for certain that God has made him, talking about Jesus, both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And when all these people, when they heard, they were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, you need to repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so he just lays it out. This is it. This is how a person comes to enter a relationship with Jesus Christ. Your home of heaven is dependent on what have you done with Jesus Christ. The gospel starts and ends with him. This is his story. You know, we say history is his story. The Bible is his story. What have you done with Jesus Christ? Then we go on intellectually, and we're not going to drill down into this, but Acts 17, we find Paul in Athens. He's reasoning with the intellectuals. You know, sometimes people don't respond to a direct gospel presentation. They respond to, you've got to reason with them and show them how Christianity is not a blind faith. It's an intelligent faith. You know, some people they've been taught that their whole life, that the Bible's irrelevant, that the Bible's, you can't trust it, there's all these errors, blah, 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 blah. Okay, and that's just what they've heard their whole life. And the reality is they don't understand there's more proof for the evidence of Scripture being true than any other book on the planet. They don't understand that one of Shakespeare's writings that we put out there, you know, as, you know, required reading in schools and all this, one of these famous literary works has, I think there's 600 and something ancient manuscripts that verify the veracity or truthfulness of that book. And nobody questions whether or not that's authentic. But what people don't realize is the Bible, the Old and New Testament, we have over 25,000 ancient documents and manuscripts that verify the truthfulness of this book. But nobody hears that. Nobody wants to acknowledge that. God's word is trustworthy. It blows any other book away. It's not even close. What's the likelihood that over 40 authors over 1,400 years are all going to agree in what they say? We can't even get two people to agree in our day and time, right? Seems like sometimes. This book is life-giving. It's filled with truth. So sometimes it requires intellectual method to share our faith. Then there's testimonial method, John 9:3. And you can just jot these down maybe and go to them later. I know, what time we got, Brother Dave? What time is it? We got about 5 minutes. Okay. All right. So jot these down, okay? Testimonial. Jesus heals the blind man, John 9:3. And he tells people about what God has done for him. Friendship evangelism, Luke 5:27-29, talks about Matthew throwing a party, having a feast, inviting people to that feast. Do you know you can share Christ in a simple way of just saying, hey, let's go grab dinner one night? Now, not just the process of having dinner, but listen, the building of a relationship. Friendship evangelism, building that relationship, looking for ways to share Christ. You know, these girls that we're ministering to, that's what we've done. We've built a relationship with them, and we're sharing Christ, sharing the gospel message through everything we're doing. Isn't that a picture of the gospel that Jesus left the comforts of his home, and he went to a place that was foreign, and he did for someone something they couldn't do for themselves? Isn't that the gospel, right? That's the gospel. And so we are being the gospel example to them in their life. Praise God. We were thrilled that the three girls placed their faith in Christ in July. And I can tell you that discipleship process, man, it's ongoing. You know, one of the girls we heard this summer, one of the girls said, I don't want to be married. Very common thing down there. Men do not respect women in their culture, both Haitian and Dominican. She said, I don't ever want to be married. Well, when Jill went back in September, she had the privilege of taking them to a Christian wedding for the first time and them seeing how a Christian wedding goes. I mean, just amazing, amazing experience for them. There's also invitational evangelism, the woman at the well. Remember the Samaritan woman. Then there's acts of service. The lady named Dorcas in Scripture in Acts 9:36-42. And some scriptures have her name as Tabitha. But there was acts of service there. These are all ways we can share the gospel with other people. All ways we can proclaim the gospel. Building relationships, confrontational, intellectual, testimonial, friendship, service. And here's something I want to say too, that sometimes we have paralysis by analysis. We think, you know what? I'm just not capable of doing these things. And so the worst thing we could, you know, we do the worst thing we can do, and that's nothing. We do nothing. Satan paralyzes us into not doing anything. That's one of his goals, is to just have us sit, soak and sour, they say. Come to church, hear the message, and we just don't do anything with what we hear. Or we open up our Bible and we read at home. We don't apply it in our life. Satan doesn't want you to put these things into practice. Yet we see in the early church, this was how they lived. This is how they functioned. They read something, then they went out and did it. They were instructed, they went out and did it. And so as people who are followers of Jesus Christ, he wants us to follow. We're to follow the commands of Christ. If I've surrendered my life, then following him is second nature. Because I've surrendered my heart when I came to faith in Christ. You know, life on earth is preparation for eternity. And we talked about how life is short. I heard yesterday while I was watching one of the games, I heard Quentin Groves, his name was mentioned. He was a former Auburn football player. He was in Trinidad celebrating his daughter's birthday, and he suddenly died in his sleep, 32 years of age. Then we had another family friend, his father, age 90, how old was Mr. Naff, 98? 98, war veteran. Lived a good long life, but his body finally gave out on him. He passed away and went into eternity. The reason I'm saying this is Scripture tells us that it's better to go to a funeral than a party and a celebration. Because it reminds us of the reality of life. It reminds us that there is an end coming to this place. There is an end coming to life here. And so because of that, we need to address that with God. We need to do business with God in our heart and life about what are we living for? What is our focus? It really has less to do about where and what. It has everything to do with that connection with God, that relationship with God. I was reading in Matthew 25, and we're going to wrap up with this. So just turn over there with me real quick. I know we're done here. Let me just say this real quick. Matthew 25. Verses 14 through 30. It's what's called, we're not going to read all that, but it's what's called the parable of the talents. Okay? And I would write this down and read through this later. It's where three people are given by their master. One's given one talent, one's given five, one's given, one, two, and five, I believe it was, Pastor Dave. They give these talents, and he comes back later to ask for an account of that. And, you know, two of the three guys, they took their talents or what was given to them, and they used it for the master. They honored the master with their use of what he had given them. The third guy who got the one talent, and one talent was equivalent to 20 years' wages for a laborer, okay? The guy with the one talent, he went and buried it. He said, because I know you're a hard guy and everything. I just wanted to keep that secure. I didn't want anything to happen to that. And so I buried it. And the Scripture says in Matthew 25 that not only did he scold him and call him a wicked servant, he also said in verse 30, he goes on, he says, cast the worthless servant into outer darkness and in that place where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Here's what I want to say to you. We're not saved by our works, okay? Salvation is by grace through faith. But I want to tell you also, when James said, I'll show you my faith by my works. Jesus said, by their works you'll know them. By their fruits or works you'll know them. If there's no desire in our life to follow the teachings of Christ in Scripture, that's an indication of a person who does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Conversely, how do we know we're saved? How do we have assurance of our salvation? When we see God and follow God's desire in Scripture to how we're supposed to interact with each other and live with each other and live for Him. Okay, does that make sense to you? And so we see this, and I share this with you because that's really what living on mission is about. We didn't get to where we're at by making decisions for our own self of what we wanted to do. Growing up, I wanted to be a sports broadcaster. All right, I figured I wasn't talented enough. That's the only way I'd get in the big game, right? But it wasn't what I wanted. It was what he wanted. And he took me through years in youth ministry, spent five great years here at Cornerstone, spent time up in Forsyth County as a church plant pastor. That's what he said, go do. We did it. And now he said, go to the Dominican Republic. So we did that. So the answer is not where you go and what you do. The way we find peace in this life is we surrender our heart and life to Jesus Christ. We surrender to what he's doing in our life. We surrender to what he's already done in the person of Jesus Christ for our hope of heaven. And we trust him for the results. We focus less on the details. We focus less on the last 10 to 20 years of our life here. We focus less on our wants and desires, and we focus on his plan. We focus on his purposes. Pastor Dave, you'll come and lead us in a time of invitation. I pray that you'll, if you haven't surrendered your heart and your life to Christ, I pray you'll do that today. And I do pray, if God's leading you to do something in regards to whether it's missions or service or just whatever the next right thing is in your relationship with Christ, I pray you'll be obedient and do that today.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust.